Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Schopenhauer, A Very Short Introduction by Christopher Janaway, narrated by Kyle Munley.
Preface. This book aims to give a sympathetic but critical account of Schopenhauer's philosophy. He constructed a system which embraces metaphysics, epistemology, philosophy of mind, aesthetics, ethics, and the meaning of life. But as a complete system, his philosophy has had few adherents, and he never founded a school of thought. His influence on the history of thought was rather that of provoking and inspiring generations of artists and thinkers from Wagner through to Wittgenstein. Some of his ideas prefigure those of Freud, and his most important philosophical impact was on Nietzsche, who at first found his pessimist conclusions attractive and later regarded them as repulsive, but was always in close dialogue with his great teacher. Schopenhauer was a true atheist who fundamentally questioned the value of human existence. Existence, for Schopenhauer, is a purposeless, painful striving driven by an unconscious force that we cannot control. Release from this existence comes from losing one's individuality in aesthetic experience, in compassion for the world, and in self-denial. While examining all the main aspects of Schopenhauer's philosophical system, this book hopes to bring out the challenging nature of the questions he asks about human existence. Christopher Janaway, August 2001. Chapter 1. Schopenhauer's Life and Works. Arthur Schopenhauer was born in 1788 in Danzig and died in Frankfurt am Main in 1860. There are a number of photographs taken during the last decade of his life, from which we derive our most immediate sense of the man. He looks unconventional and grimly determined, but the sparkle in his eye is that of someone vigilant, incisive, and capable of mischief, not altogether different from the persona which emerges from his writings. At the end of his life, Schopenhauer was just beginning to enjoy a measure of fame. His philosophy, however, is not a product of old or middle age. Although most of the words which he published were written after he settled in Frankfurt at the age of 45, it was in the years between 1810 and 1818 that he had produced the entire philosophical system for which he became celebrated. As Nietzsche later wrote, "We should remember that it was the creative, rebellious energy of a man in his 20s which produced the world as will and representation." The mature Schopenhauer occupied himself in consolidating and supplementing the position he had presented in this masterpiece, which was, until very near the end of his life, neglected by the intellectual world. Independence of spirit is the trait most characteristic of Schopenhauer. He writes fearlessly with little respect for authority, and detests the hollow conformism which he finds in the German academic establishment. But behind this is the significant fact that he was also financially independent. When he came of age in 1809, he inherited wealth which, with astute management, was sufficient to see him through the rest of his life. His father, Heinrich Floris Schopenhauer, had been one of the wealthiest businessmen in Danzig at the time of Arthur's birth. A cosmopolitan man, committed to the liberal values of the Enlightenment and to republicanism, he left Danzig when it was annexed by Prussia and moved to the free city of Hamburg. Arthur had in common with his father a love of French and English culture and a horror of Prussian nationalism. The name Arthur was chosen because it was shared by several European languages. Though the intention here was chiefly to fit the infant for his envisaged career in pan-European commerce. Later, Arthur felt he had also inherited his father's intense, obsessive personality. His father's death in 1805, probably by suicide, was a great blow to him. Schopenhauer received a broad and enriching education in school, enhanced by the travel and social contacts that his wealthy family made possible. Sent to France at the age of 9 when his sister was born, he acquired fluent French. After some years of schooling, at the age of 15, he embarked with his parents on a 2-year trip to Holland, England, France, Switzerland, and Austria. He saw many of the famous sights of the day, and at times was deeply affected by the poverty and suffering he witnessed. While his parents toured Britain, however, he was consigned to a boarding school in Wimbledon, whose narrow, disciplinarian, religious outlook, a marked contrast to the education he had hitherto received, made a negative impression that was to last. This episode says much about Schopenhauer's character and upbringing. He was a seething, belligerent pupil who would not submit to the stultifying practices that surrounded him, and he seems quite isolated in his defiance. His parents wrote to him, his father niggling about his handwriting, his mother gushing about the wonderful time they were having and pleading with him to take a more reasonable attitude, but neither showed much inclination to seeing things from his point of view. It is tempting to view the situation as a microcosm of his later life. As his life progressed, it became clearer that it would not be constructed around close relationships with others. He began to see company as like a fire, at which the prudent man warms himself at a distance, and resolved to be lonely even when with others, for fear of losing his own integrity. He later wrote that 5/6 of human beings were worth only contempt, but equally saw that there were inner obstacles to human contact. Nature has done more than is necessary to isolate my heart, in that she endowed it with suspicion, sensitiveness, vehemence, and pride. He was prone to depression and confessed, "I always have an anxious concern that causes me to see and look for dangers where none exist." Some writers on Schopenhauer's personality have looked to his relationships with his parents, and what they have found is not surprising. His father was an anxious, exacting, and formidable man, very ambitious for his son. Johanna Schopenhauer, nie Trosina, also from a successful business family in Danzig, was quite different. A lively, sociable person, she had literary aspirations, which culminated in a career as a romantic novelist, making her, during her lifetime, more famous than her son. She was a significant force in his life, but relations between them were never warm. In her marriage, too, as she wrote herself, she saw no need to feign ardent love for her husband, adding that he did not expect it. After Heinrich Schopenhauer died, the independently minded Johanna was free to embark on her own career and moved to Weimar, where she established an artistic and intellectual salon frequented by many of the luminaries of the day. Arthur benefited from some of the relationships he established in this circle, notably with Goethe, and with the Oriental scholar Friedrich Meyer, who stimulated in him a lifelong interest in Indian thought. However, his relationship with his mother became stormy, and in 1814 she threw him out for good, never to see him again. By the time this happened, Schopenhauer had abandoned the career in business which his father had projected for him, and had found his way into the life of learning. In 1809, he went to the university at Göttingen, where he was to move on to Berlin 2 years later. He attended lectures on a variety of scientific subjects, having originally intended to study medicine, but he soon gravitated towards philosophy. The Göttingen philosopher G. E. Schulze played a decisive role in Schopenhauer's career when he advised him to begin by reading the works of Plato and Kant. Though Schopenhauer was, by any standards, a widely read and scholarly thinker, it is fair to say that his reading of these two philosophers provoked in him the fundamental ideas that shaped his philosophy from then on. The Hindu Upanishads, which he learned of through Friedrich Meyer, were the third ingredient which he later blended with Platonic and Kantian elements to make something quite original in The World as Will and Representation. When he moved to Berlin, Schopenhauer heard lectures from Schleiermacher and Fichte, two of the philosophical heavyweights of the day, though, true to form, he was fairly contemptuous of them, and certainly did not seem to think he was there to absorb what they had to say. His lecture notes and marginal annotations to the books he was reading, preserved in manuscript remains, show him keen to object and debate, and, for a young student, he reacts with an almost uncanny sureness of his own position. This, too, is a pattern that was not to vary greatly. Schopenhauer did not learn in association with others, by exchanging ideas and submitting himself to scrutiny. He learned and wrote by relying on his own judgment and treating other people's ideas as raw material to be hammered into the shape he wanted. What he could not use, he sometimes decried as rubbish, with a witty style of mockery that usually succeeds in keeping the reader on his side. Schopenhauer would have made far less of himself without such single-minded determination, but the same feature has its compensating weakness. It can be a virtue for a philosopher to exhibit more give and take, more sense of dialogue and self-criticism, than Schopenhauer sometimes does. When Schopenhauer was ready to write his doctoral thesis in 1813, war broke out. Schopenhauer had an aversion to fighting, and even more of an aversion to fighting on the Prussian side against the French. He fled south to Rudolstadt near Weimar, and there completed his first work, On the Fourfold Root of the Principle of Sufficient Reason, which gained him his doctorate at Jena and was published in an edition of 500 copies in the same year. The book takes a stock academic topic, the principle of sufficient reason, which says that for everything that is, there must be a ground or reason why it is, lays out concisely the ways in which it has been dealt with in the history of philosophy, then proceeds to a four-part explanation of the different kinds of reason. The systematic framework is derived from Kant, whose thought Schopenhauer has clearly assimilated, though not uncritically. There are enough twists to make this the beginning of something new, and more than a hint of what is to come in his major work. Schopenhauer always considered the fourfold root essential to understanding his thought, and undertook a revision of it for republication in 1847. Another early publication is the essay On Vision and Colors of 1816. This short book is a product of his involvement with Goethe, whose anti-Newtonian theory of colors had been published at the beginning of the decade. In discussing this theory, Schopenhauer and Goethe came to know each other quite well. Schopenhauer did not regard it as a central project of his own, but understandably did not turn down the invitation to work with one of the greatest men he was ever likely to meet. Goethe, 40 years his senior, recognized the rigor of Schopenhauer's mind and regarded him as someone with great potential, but was less concerned to foster his talent than to receive help in his own intellectual endeavors. The brief period in which they worked together is the one exceptional collaboration in Schopenhauer's career, but still he did not have it in him to become anyone's disciple. His own work, On Vision and Colors, diverged somewhat from Goethe's thinking, and he did not disguise the fact that he thought it superior. The partnership tailed off, Schopenhauer disappointed, though not crushed, by Goethe's lukewarm response. He later sent Goethe a copy of The World as Will and Representation, and had an apparently cordial meeting with him in 1819. But by now the two had parted company. As Goethe was to say, they were like two people who eventually shook hands, one turning to go south, the other north. Schopenhauer's true destination is revealed in Volume 1 of The World as Will and Representation, which he completed in Dresden and published in 1818, although 1819 is the date that stands on the title page. The dispassionate Kantian exercise which Schopenhauer carried out in The Fourfold Root in 1813 did not reveal the driving force of his philosophy. It did not address questions concerning suffering and salvation, ethics and art, sexuality, death, and the meaning of life. But it was in these areas that his preoccupations already lay. The collected manuscript remains show Schopenhauer's greatest book in a process of composition over a period of almost 10 years. Adapting the thought of both Plato and Kant, he had become convinced that there was a split between ordinary consciousness and a higher, or better, state in which the human mind could pierce beyond mere appearances to a knowledge of something more real. The thought had aesthetic and religious overtones. Schopenhauer wrote of both the artist and the saint as possessing this better consciousness, though it should be said straight away that his philosophical system is atheist through and through. He also struck one of the keynotes of pessimism, saying that the life of ordinary experience, in which we strive and desire and suffer, is something from which to be liberated. Such thoughts were well established in Schopenhauer's mind by 1813. The idea which allowed his monumental book to take shape was his conception of the will. In the finished work, as its title indicates, Schopenhauer presents the world as having two sides, that of the Vorstellung, representation, or the way things present themselves to us in experience, and that of the Wille, will, which is, he argues, what the world is in itself, beyond the mere appearances to which human knowledge is limited. The will is not easy to define. It is, to begin with, easier to say what it is not. It is not any kind of mind or consciousness, nor does it direct things to any rational purpose. Otherwise, will would be another name for God. Schopenhauer's world is purposeless. His notion of will is probably best captured by the notion of striving towards something, provided one remembers that the will is fundamentally blind and found in forces of nature which are without consciousness at all. Most importantly, the human psyche can be seen as split, comprising not only capacities for understanding and rational thought, but at a deeper level, also an essentially blind process of striving, which governs, but can also conflict with, the conscious portions of our nature. Humanity is poised between the life of an organism driven to survival and reproduction, and that of a pure intellect that can rebel against its nature and aspire to a timeless contemplation of a higher reality. Though he does still envisage a kind of resigned salvation, Schopenhauer thinks ordinary existence must involve the dual miseries of pain and boredom, insisting that it is in the very essence of humanity, indeed of the world as a whole, that it should be so. Many have found Schopenhauer's philosophy impossible to accept as a single, consistent metaphysical scheme. But it does have great strength and coherence as a narrative, and in the dynamic interplay between its different conceptions of the world and the self. What is set down at the beginning should be treated not so much as a foundation for everything that is to come, but as a first idea which will be revealed as inadequate by a second that seems to undermine it, only to reassert itself in transformed guise later on. There is a superficial resemblance here to the method of his contemporary Hegel, though everything to do with Hegel was anathema to Schopenhauer, and in other respects they could hardly differ more as writers. Thomas Mann likened Schopenhauer's book to a great symphony in four movements, and it is helpful to approach it in something of this spirit, seeking contrasts of mood and unities of theme amid a wealth of variations. Certainly there have been few philosophers who have equaled Schopenhauer's grasp of literary architecture and pacing, and few whose prose style is so eloquent. For all this, the great work went virtually unnoticed for many years after its publication. Schopenhauer was embittered, but he was not one to think that the world was right and he was wrong. He continued throughout his life to believe in the supreme value of his work. In 1820, he was awarded the right to lecture at the University of Berlin after speaking before a gathering of the faculty chaired by Hegel, the professor of philosophy. Schopenhauer duly presented himself to lecture under the stunning title, The Whole of Philosophy, that is, the theory of the essence of the world and of the human mind. But he had chosen to speak at the same time as Hegel. 200 attended the lecture of the professor, who was at the peak of his career, and the unknown Schopenhauer was left with a pitiful few. His name was on the lecture schedule in later years, but he never returned to repeat the experience, and this was the end of his lecturing career. Hegel was the epitome of everything that Schopenhauer disliked in philosophy. He was a career academic who made use of the institutional authority which Schopenhauer held in contempt. He upheld the church and the state, for which Schopenhauer, an atheist and an individualist, had no time. Although thoroughly conservative himself, Schopenhauer regarded the political state merely as a convenient means for protecting property and curbing the excesses of egoism. He could not stomach Hegel's representation of the state as the whole aim of human existence. Hegel was also an appalling stylist who seemed to build abstraction upon abstraction without the breath of fresh air provided by common sense experience, and Schopenhauer, not alone in this, found his writing pompous and obscurantist, even dishonest. The emblem at the head of Hegelian university philosophy, he says, should be a cuttlefish creating a cloud of obscurity around itself so that no one sees what it is, with the legend Mea caligine tutus, fortified by my own obscurity. It is not true to say that Schopenhauer's philosophy was based on opposition to Hegel. Hegel was far from his mind as he created his major work. But Hegel's triumphant success, coupled with his own continuing lack of recognition, nevertheless produced in him a rancor which dominated much of his subsequent career. During the 1820s, Schopenhauer was at his least productive. He traveled to Italy, suffered during and after his return journey from serious illness and depression, and continued an affair with Caroline Richter, a chorus girl at the National Theater in Berlin. He planned a number of writing projects, such as translations of Hume's works on religion and of Sterne's Tristram Shandy, but nothing came of them. His notebooks were filled, sometimes with invective against Hegelianism, which he reworked for inclusion in later works, but he completed no more publications while in Berlin. It is especially sad that the English publisher he approached about translating Kant's Critique of Pure Reason and other works should have turned him down. Schopenhauer's English was good, his feel for literary form superb, and his knowledge of Kant's work intimate. One can only speculate how the history of ideas would have been affected had he succeeded in making Kant more accessible to the English-speaking world at this comparatively early date. By contrast, a result of his scholarship to which we are indebted is the rediscovery of the first edition of the Critique, which was republished in 1838, partly thanks to his efforts. In 1831, cholera reached Berlin, apparently claiming Hegel among its victims, and Schopenhauer left the city. After some indecision, he settled in Frankfurt, where he was to continue living an outwardly uneventful life, balanced between writing and recreation. Theater, opera, walking, playing the flute, dining out, and reading The Times in the town's library. Now he was able to produce more books. In 1836, he published On the Will in Nature, which was designed to support his doctrine of the will by putting forward corroborative scientific evidence from independent sources. It is still a work of interest, although arguably it does not stand very well on its own apart from The World as Will and Representation. However, in 1838 and 1839, Schopenhauer entered for two essay competitions set by the Norwegian Royal Scientific Society and its Danish counterpart, and the two occasions produced a pair of fine self-standing essays, On the Freedom of the Will and On the Basis of Morality, which were published together in 1841 under the title The Two Fundamental Problems of Ethics. In terms of doctrine, these pieces are not radical departures from his earlier works, but both are well-constructed and persuasive pieces in which local parts of the grand design are presented with clarity. They can readily be recommended to a student of ethics today. In the essay on freedom, Schopenhauer presents a convincing case for determinism, only to say, as some more recent philosophers have, that the deeper issue of freedom and responsibility are scarcely resolved thereby. This essay was rewarded with a gold medal by the Norwegians. The second essay, part of which is a thorough criticism of Kant's ethics, suffered a different fate in Denmark. Despite its being the only entry, the Royal Society refused to award it a prize. It had not, they judged, successfully answered the question set, and they took exception to the unseemly manner in which a number of recent philosophers of distinction had been referred to. "Who do they mean?" asked Schopenhauer in his preface to the essays. "Fichte and Hegel. Are these men the summa philosophy one is not allowed to insult?" It is true that Schopenhauer had not been playing the conventional game of academic politeness, but now he seizes the chance to let rip with all the means at his command. He produces an escalating series of allegations about the emptiness and confusion of Hegel's philosophy, throwing in a picturesque quote from Homer about the chimera, which is a compound of many beasts, and ending, "Further, if I were to say that this summus philosophus of the Danish Academy scribbled nonsense quite unlike any mortal before him, so that whoever could read his most eulogized work, the so-called Phenomenology of Mind, without feeling as if he were in a madhouse, would qualify as an inmate for Bedlam, I should be no less right." In 1844, a second volume of The World as Will and Representation was published along with a new edition of the first volume. Schopenhauer was wise in not trying to rewrite his youthful work. What he provides instead is a substantial elaboration of the original, clarifying and extending it with the benefit of mature reflection. The second volume is actually longer than the first, and the two combine well to produce a single work. They were published together again in a third edition in 1859, the year before he died. Schopenhauer's final new publication was another two-volume book, entitled Parierga and Paralipomena, which appeared in 1851. The imposing title means Complementary Works and Matters Omitted, and the contents range from extended philosophical essays to the more popular Aphorisms on the Wisdom of Life, which have often been published separately. Somewhat strangely, it was this late work, which was reviewed favorably first in England, that led to Schopenhauer's becoming well known. There was demand for new editions of his writing, and he even became a topic for German university courses. He received many visitors and much correspondence, including the complete libretto of The Ring of the Nibelung from an ardent fan, Richard Wagner, of whose music, incidentally, he did not think very highly. In the first 50 years after his death, Schopenhauer was to become one of the most influential writers of Europe. Though he made no claim to be a poet, the verses which came to stand at the very end of Parierga and Paralipomena are no doubt an honest reflection of what he felt in his last years. 1856. Finale. I now stand weary at the end of the road. The jaded brow can hardly bear the laurel, and yet I gladly see what I have done, ever undaunted by what others say. Chapter 2. Within and Beyond Appearance. Appearance and the Thing in Itself. Schopenhauer's philosophical thinking is easiest to grasp if one first sees the backbone that runs right through it. This is the distinction, which he found in Kant, between appearance and the thing in itself. The world of appearance consists of things as we know them by the ordinary means of sense experience and scientific investigation. In other words, the empirical world. Appearance is not to be understood as straightforward illusion. The things that meet us in our empirical knowledge are not hallucinations, but to use the Greek word for appearances, they are the phenomena that make up the world. However, there is still the question whether the whole world consists only of these phenomena. Should we regard what there is as being exhausted by our empirical knowledge? We can at least conceive of a reality independent of what we could experience. And this is what Kant meant by talking of things in themselves. Kant's achievement was to show that knowledge was limited. We could never know how the world was in itself, only how it could appear to us as scientists or ordinary perceivers. The pretensions of traditional metaphysics to know about God, the immortality of the soul, or a supernatural order pervading the whole universe were therefore doomed. According to Schopenhauer's assessment in his Critique of the Kantian Philosophy, Kant had added to this destructive achievement two others that were more positive. The first was the idea that the world of appearance had fundamental and necessary organizing principles which could be discovered. The second was the view that ethics could be separated off from the sphere of appearance, and was not knowledge in the way that science was.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.